whether you're joining us on Facebook Live, on our website, on YouTube, go ahead, click that share button, make your comments known, hit the like button, the love button, go ahead, put those comments. Praise the Lord, happy Valentine's Day, family. But here, we are here to give our attention and our love to God this morning, amen. So we're going to focus on Him, put aside all those other things, and give God the glory this morning, amen. Hallelujah.
You are here. As we lift you up, you are riding on our praise, being thrown over everything. You are seated in our praise.
This is prophetic, I can feel it in the air.
We lift our praise and you change the atmosphere. With hearts open now, everybody sing.
Thank you.
There's hope for your loved ones. There is hope for our nation this morning. In Him, all the promises we could ever need, we have. So this morning, let's rejoice in that. Let's shout to the Lord this morning. Let's shout, shout. Oh, shout to the Lord, all the earth. Let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your day. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I love you, forever stand. Nothing compares to the promise of nothing. Nothing compares to the promise I have. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. Oh, just sing out his love song to the Lord. Oh, nothing compares to you. Oh, I love you, Lord. Oh, I need you. Tell him you need him this morning. Tell him you want him this morning. From the very depths of your being, let him know that you need him. Cry out to him. Worship him. Praise him.
Valentine's Day, church, Facebook, family, and friends. We're going to pray. Believe God Almighty, the God that's more than enough. Let's just open our hearts up and just thank Him. For as we celebrate Valentine's Day, there's no greater love than the love that the Father had for us in sending Jesus, His Son, to bring us back together in oneness. So, Father, we thank you. We thank you for your plan, Lord, and your love, Lord, that's unconditional, that's greater. You said greater than the greatest, the depths of the sea. Father, we thank you, Father God, for your love towards us. We love you back, Father. Help us, Lord, to be that covenant maker. Father, help us to be the church and the bride, Father, that you're desiring for us to be. Church, I ask that you would just ask the Lord for grace to abound and for your strength and for your preparation and longing for the coming of our Lord Jesus, for He's coming soon. Father, we pray today, Father, for our country, Lord God, for our nation, Father, to come together in unity, Lord God. Bring us together, Lord, as only you can. We pray, Lord God, for plans of men to fall by the wayside. And Lord, let your plan, Lord God, and your will be done in the United States of America. And Lord, bless the nations of the world, Lord God. Bring us together, I pray. Reap a harvest of souls, Lord. Lord, we pray for the Holy Spirit and the conviction and the moving power of the Holy Spirit to pull and to draw people to the cross of Christ, that together we will rejoice for all of eternity. In the mighty name of Jesus. And Father, we pray, Father, for marriages, Lord God, for relationships, Lord God. Let them be covenant-making, Father God. Let us be covenant people again, Lord God. Help us, Father God. Bring our marriages stronger. Bring our families closer, that the light of Christ would shine through us. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray a covering, Lord God, over your church, Lord God, over our families and friends, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Lord God, I pray that you would save them, Lord God. Father, save them, I pray, in Jesus' name, and use us, Father, as laborers in your field, Lord God. We pray for opportunities, Lord God, to share our testimony and to be a witness for the Lord Jesus Christ. Lord, we thank you, Father God, all across the nation and this nation and the nations of the world. May the word of the Lord be preached, Lord God, as a witness, Lord. So, Lord, you will come back soon, Father God. Thank you for your blessings, Lord God, upon us. Thank you for increase and prosperity. And, Lord, we ask that you would help us be that obedient servant, Lord God. Help us be that obedient son and daughter, Father God. That the riches that you prepared for us, Lord God, that you can release them and that we would receive them with a good heart, Father God. Thank you, Lord God, for prospering your church and growing us. In the name of Jesus, we speak blessings upon blessings, Father, upon Encounter Church, upon the body of Christ. Father God, bring us together as one. As you said, Lord Jesus, in your word, Father, let us be one, Lord. So, Lord, we ask that the church be one with you. In the mighty name of Jesus, in the mighty name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Father, we just thank you again this morning. Happy Valentine's Day, church. We love you. Father, we come before you this morning, Lord, lifting up Apostle Jim and Pastor Joni, Father. Father, we plead the blood of Jesus over them continually. We ask, Father God, that you continue to equip them, Father God, for such a time as this, Father. For we know that everywhere their feet tread, you've ordained, Father. So we pray, Father God, that as their feet tread, you continue to open up doors for them in the mighty name of Jesus. We plead the blood of Jesus over their family, Father, that no weapon formed against them and their family will prosper. Father, we thank you for men and women that you've put, a man and a woman that you've put in this house, Father, with your heart to love upon your people. And Father, we just pray right now for those in authority, Father God, in the natural and in the spiritual. We cover our president and vice president and those in office and political office. We pray for the fivefold ministry right now in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father God. Lord and Father, we cover Encounter Church and those watching with us this morning with the blood. That wherever you're at right now, yes, you watching this morning, whether you're in the house, whether you're in a hotel room, wherever you are right now, in the name of Jesus, we plead the blood of Jesus over you and your loved ones. And listen, the Lord says that it is time for our relationships to be taken to another level in love. As today is Valentine's Day, the day of love, Father, we thank you that we are greater and greater in love with you together, all of us watching, and for what you're going to do this morning, in Jesus' name.
as we continue this beautiful Valentine's morning, this beautiful Valentine's Day, let's remember the one who loved us the most. He gave his life. What more could he give? So let's sing this old chorus. So beautiful.
Say it, babe.
He truly loves you, and he loves me, and he loves us. Simple song, but so profound.
Wow. The power of God is in the house.
Surely is.
Happy, happy Valentine's.
Valentine's Day to each and every one of you. God bless you. Happy Valentine's Day. God bless.
Where would we be without the anointing of the Holy Spirit? What an incredible team we have here, live in the sanctuary of Encounter Church.
Yes.
People that know how to praise and pray. Praise and pray.
Yes, truly.
People that know how to raise them and praise them.
And praise them.
This is the day the Lord has made.
Yes.
It's good to rejoice. It's good to be glad. Happy Valentine's Day to each and every one of you. No matter who you are,
yes,
where you are,
mm-hmm,
will you be
my,
our
Valentine?
Yes.
Yes.
Will you be mine?
Yes, I will. Will you be mine?
Yes.
Yes.
But.
Awesome.
But will you be ours?
Yeah. Will you?
Thank you. Thank you. Well, guess what? What an anointing in this house. Wow.
It's rich.
All over the country, from coast to coast, by the power of the Holy Ghost. Well, guess what, people of God? Wherever you're watching from, whatever city, state, region, nation, today is the coldest Valentine's Day on record.
Oh, my.
Today is the cold.
Did not know that. That's crazy.
Yep. Today is the coldest Valentine's Day on record. And as we speak right now, here, mm-hmm, aquí, right here in Bartlett, Illinois, it's -2.
Oh.
-2, -2. I don't know how else to say it. And that's without the wind chill factor. With the wind chill, it is minus 27 degrees. Minus 27 degrees. I have it. Minus 27 degrees with the wind chill. Without the wind chill, minus 2 degrees. But the good news is it's going to warm up today.
Oh, tell me.
Well, do you know how warm it's
going to get? It's going to get what?
I think it may get up to, Pastor Derek, what's the latest?
Latest I saw was 4.
Four above?
Four above.
Four above.
Nice balmy 4 above.
Nice balmy 4 above. So
Tropical heat wave.
And I just spoke, just 10 minutes ago, I spoke to my friends in Orlando. 10 minutes ago, I spoke to my friends in Orlando. Joe Mano, who's a pastor there. And Mark Sharona, Bishop Mark Sharona. Just minutes ago, I spoke to them both. Listen to this. It's 70 degrees right now in Orlando. It's 70 degrees, but many people are not coming to church because it's raining outside. Oh, Lord. You know, flesh is flesh everywhere. Everywhere. Chicago, Orlando, any and everywhere, flesh is flesh. But yet people can make it to work. They can get to work. Anyway, I'm grateful for you and Encounter Church and for all of God's people. I really am. I'm just throwing that out there, though. We communicated about 10, 12 minutes ago saying it's 70 degrees, but there's light rain. Bishop Sharona said people are afraid that they're going to melt in the rain. You know, folks, when you're hungry for God, you'll find a way. In Encounter Church, you're hungry for God. You're hungry for God. And I thank God for my dear friends like Joe Mano and Bishop Mark Sharona who hunger for God.
Yes.
And I know their people, their congregations hunger for God as well. But the body in general needs a wake-up call and to be so in love with God like the way you are, Encounter Church, the way you are, Facebook friends. Yeah, so it's chilly outside here. So aren't you glad, Encounter Church? Come on, be very honest. You would not be anything else. Okay? Be honest, you would not be anything else. Although we'd like to meet in person, and we're going to get to that. We'll get to that place again.
Yeah.
Pastor Joni's going to tell you a little bit about that in just a minute. But come on, let's be honest. And I know you will always be with us. Aren't you glad you're home today? A little bit? That you didn't have to leave the house? Or maybe some of you had to leave the house? Aren't you glad we're having church this way today? A little bit? A little bit? A little bit? You didn't have to put your coat on and warm up the car? A little bit? Well, don't get used to being too comfortable, because when we're back in the building again, you know how it's going to be. But the fire of God will always be here. But you stay warm. You stay warm.
Yes.
Safe and comfortable. But just don't get too comfortable, because we want to stay engaged in the presence of the Lord.
Amen.
Hey, we love you so much. We really do. Happy Valentine's Day to you. We'll tell you right now, if our arms were long enough, we'd give you one big hug, and if our lips were big enough, we'd give you one big kiss. Yes. Some of you may know by now that on Friday, Dr. Fred Price went home to be with the Lord. He went home to be with the Lord. He was 89, but 89 years young. And we want to keep First Lady Betty Price and Fred Price Jr., who is now the senior pastor, Fred Price Jr., and all the church family in our prayers there in Crenshaw Christian Center in California. Dr. Price, Fred Price, was a great man of faith.
Yes.
We used to watch his program every week. We'd watch his program, Evidence. Does your life show enough evidence? Well, he was a patriarch in the Lord, Dr. Price was. But we pray for First Lady Betty and the family and church family.
Yes.
We pray God comfort them and give them great peace in the matchless mighty name of Jesus. Yes. We pray for the church family, for God's touch upon them even now. And Lord, we thank you for the legacy of Dr. Fred Price.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord. And I remember when I lived in New York City. Where?
New York City.
New York City. I remember when I lived in New York City, I purchased his book. Well, he's written many books.
Right.
But one of his books was on faith, foolishness, and presumption.
Right, I remember
that. You remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Some of you may remember his book on faith, foolishness, and presumption. To this day, that book resonates in my mind and in my heart.
Yeah.
Because many Christians do things out of foolishness and not faith, or presumption and not faith.
Right.
And that man's legacy lives in me today. And although he's with the Lord, his legacy remains on this earth. And again, it resonates in me and in many of you as well. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. So the positivity rate is continuing to go down, down, down for Chicagoland and for Illinois. 3.6 it's at right now. 3.6%. Isn't that awesome? It used to be around 14%, now 3.6%. So we just want to continue to keep praying that this virus will dry and die, but just not for Chicagoland or for Illinois.
Everywhere.
But we want it for our nation and the nations throughout this world. We just want it to dry and die and be done. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen. So this Wednesday, we'll have our Facebook Live at 7 o'clock. It's going to be great. It's going to be awesome. We don't know how the wind is going to blow, but we know it's the Holy Spirit's going to come and have his way. So we're looking forward to that Wednesday at 7 p.m. Facebook Live, community night. We're going to come together and be a family, right? I love that. And then, of course, at 7:20 is when the youth are going to meet and young adults with Pastor Eddie and Miss Kayleen, and they have a great time. They're growing in the things of God, and we're so proud of them, and we love them so much. We continue to pray for them, right? And all the Pastor Eddie and Miss Kayleen as well, because God, we just want God to continue to propel them forward and do something mighty in each and every one of their lives. So proud of them. Alrighty, and then next Sunday, at a week from today, during our Facebook Live service, April Wells is going to be ministering in honor of Black History Month. So that's going to be really special, because this, of course, is Black History Month. So this coming Sunday, we're going to have April Wells minister, and we're looking forward to that.
Very much. And now listen to this announcement, as well as the others of you have been, because they're all exciting, what you've shared.
Right.
But this one I'm really pumped up for, as well as next Sunday, which I'm pumped up for. But we long to see you, church, face to face. You know that. What Paul said to the church at Thessalonica, I long to be with you face to face.
Right.
Well, guess what? Tell them, babe.
So next month, we're in February, but next month is March. And as we know, we spring ahead in March. March is spring. Isn't that awesome? So once again, we're going to be having our Sunday drive-in services. So we're looking forward to that. And it's going to be great. It's going to be great. And then, of course, you know, everything is going to be falling into place. The days are going to be longer. The days are going to be warmer. And spring is upon us. It's good. It's upon us. You know, February is kind of a short month, but, you know, we endure the weather for February, but yet March will have our payoff, right?
Yep.
And we have our drive-in services starting in March.
Yep. Somebody comment, think spring. Think spring.
I like that.
And we plan on having our first one at the very end of March.
Okay.
In fact, the plan is for Palm Sunday.
Oh, nice.
Palm Sunday, which I believe, Pastor Derek, is that the last Sunday in March?
That is the last Sunday in March. I believe it's March 28th.
March 28th.
Palm Sunday.
Palm Sunday. So we plan on.
Perfect.
The game plan is to have our first drive-in service. You guys love drive-ins, boy. You guys know how to honk those horns. Drive-ins, drive-throughs. And so we're planning for the last Sunday in March. So we know it'll be a lot warmer then. Not saying how warm, but it's going to be a lot warmer.
Yes.
But of course, we'll do everything based on the leading of the Lord, and the weather conditions have a factor. But we're looking forward to that. And we're going to have palms for you to wave out your window if you'd like. And if it's warm enough, you can get out of your car. Then the next Sunday after that will be the first Sunday in April. And that's Easter Sunday, Resurrection Sunday. So we look forward to having our drive-in services again. And before you know it, as this virus dries and dies, we'll just take it a week at a time, a month at a time, and see how the Lord continues to lead us as he has.
That's
because
right.
We've been safe. We've been safe as a church. We've been safe from this virus for about a year now as
yes.
a church. And we thank the Lord for that. I know some
Absolutely.
Have been affected by it, but they've gotten over it.
Amen.
They're healed. But we haven't lost anybody.
Amen.
And we thank God for that. So
Very
we look
grateful.
Forward to all
Very
that
grateful.
The Lord has for us.
Amen. Amen. And also, if you have a prayer need, or if someone is sick, or perhaps it was a death in the family, or a birth in the family, please call the church and let us know, or email the church. Those are the two best ways to communicate. We don't consider Facebook a way of communicating with each other as far as those kind of special things that are needed to be known. So please make sure, in the event of a prayer request or a death, a birth, something like that, please let us know, okay, especially if you're sick in body, and we want to know about those things so we can pray and let you know that we're there for you. Alrighty, and as we know, Facebook is unreliable in that capacity. Thank you so much, and then also please check your emails regularly, and also check your spam and your junk, okay, because spam and junk a lot of times holds an email that, you know, we just go into our regular email and we totally pass by what maybe communication the church has sent out to you. So you want to check your spam or your junk and make sure nothing is in there. Okay? Thank you so much.
All righty.
All righty.
You can go have a seat.
Okay.
And I'll see you in a few minutes.
I will. Okay.
Pastor Eddie, why don't you come on up here for a moment and give us an update on your looks. Give us an update on your looks and your beard. But really, just proclaim, declare, prophesy the vision of the house to the people.
Good morning, church. So you see the beard is trimmed, and I did get my hair did or done. But thank you, church. Listen, together, our vision is to encounter the presence of God. To encounter the presence of God, and to equip people of all backgrounds to become disciples of Jesus Christ, laborers for his kingdom. Church, one united family, having one heart with one purpose, together as one team, touching our community and reaching the world. That is the encounter vision. That is our vision. That is your vision. In Jesus' name, love you.
Oh, stay there, Pastor Eddie. Turn around, let people see you. Oh, boy.
Aren't those cool?
All right.
Braids are cool.
Lord, we pray for deliverance over Pastor Eddie. he is cool. You know, what can I say? Thank you, Pastor Derek. He is cool, and we love him, and he's a good son in the Lord. We love him. He's a good son in the Lord. And you mentioned Kayleen, and we just
she's a good daughter in the Lord.
She is, yeah. We have a blessed church, don't we, babe?
Yes, we do.
We sure do.
We have a loving church, blessed church, and they're cute, too.
They are cute and handsome.
Yes.
Yeah, like handsome over, right?
No, handsome okay. isn't handsome.
All right. Are you ready for the word of the Lord? Yes? Yeah. Are you ready for the word of the Lord?
Yes.
All right. Well, we have a Valentine's Day message for you. And it's not just your traditional Valentine's Day message. It's a message of love in lieu of everything that is happening in our society, in our world, in our nation.
Right.
In your home, in your house. So happy Valentine's Day again. And if you'd like to make comments, I see many of you are, feel free to. Feel free to share. Give us a like. Let us know you're out there. And
yes, we would like to know that.
We'd like to know that. So today, let's get right to the bullseye. Because Valentine's Day is about what? See the hearts behind us? You know what it's about. It's not about rejection. It's not about loneliness. It's about love. And love is the center of all things. Love is the center of all things, which means love is the root of everything. So, babe, when we think about Valentine's Day, we think about love, but the root of it all, to love, requires the heart.
Yes.
So love starts in the heart.
I like that. And in Proverbs 4:23, it says, guard and protect your heart with all diligence, for out of it flows the issues of life.
Mm.
So let's think about that. Our heart is to be guarded. Our heart is not a garbage dump. Our heart is something to be guarded. And if there's something that we know that isn't right or that we know better, we need to guard our heart and guard our ways of life. But we need to guard and protect our heart, because out of it, God speaks through that, and God uses our heart. So we want something that's very precious to the Lord. We want to hold precious as well.
Yes. Amen? Yeah. So guard and protect your heart with all diligence.
Diligence.
So be on guard. Be on guard of negative people. We love everybody. Be
right.
on guard of negative conversations. We love conversations, but not negative conversations. Be on guard of what you listen to, who you associate with,
right.
where you go, where you don't go, what you see with your eyes, hear with your ears, what you sense with your senses. Guard your heart. I promise you, if you guard your heart, you won't get offended. If you guard your heart, frustration will dissipate. If you guard your heart, God will be able to move in a tremendous way, because out of your heart flows the issues of life. God created your heart for life, to
yes.
speak life, to bring life, to do life. Amen?
Amen. And in Proverbs 20:27, it says, the spirit of a person is the lamp or the flashlight of the Lord. Don't
the
you
spirit,
love that?
The heart.
Is the lamp or the flashlight of the Lord, searching all the inner depths or rooms of one's heart. So there's very many, many portions, we could say, of our heart that sometimes we don't know in life unless we're walking through situations and we say, you know what? That's a part of my heart that I don't think I rendered to the Lord. I don't think I gave that part of my heart to the Lord yet. And we have to be open to those things, because sometimes it could be like a merry-go-round situation where you think you've dealt with it and you haven't, and it comes again. And sometimes you just have to be frank with yourself and honest with yourself and just deal with it. If it's jealousy, if it's envy, if it's, you know, holding a grudge or whatever it is, you got to deal with it and just cut it off. Let it be done.
Mm-hmm.
And walk away from that.
Yeah. Because your heart is the flashlight. Your heart is the seer. Listen, your heart is the seer. And God wants you to have a pure heart. He wants me and us to have a pure heart so that we can see clearly. Remember the song, I Can See Clearly Now, right? We want to be able to see clearly. We want to see people through the eyes of the Lord. We want to see people the way Jesus sees people. But if our heart is cluttered with the filth of this world or the pollution of strife or envy or bitterness, then we're going to mislead ourselves. We're going to misguide ourselves. So a spirit of a person is a lamp or the flashlight of the Lord, searching all the inner depths or rooms of your heart, all the rooms of your heart. So we want to surrender all the rooms, all the chambers.
Yes.
Like in our hearts, we have four chambers, four valves we have.
Right.
We want to make sure that every part of our heart is clean before God and allow Him to search, because He is Lord over our hearts. He is Lord over our spirit. And when He reigns in our spirit, love flows like a fountain. The spirit of a person is a lamp or flashlight of the Lord. So you become a flashlight in your spirit when your spirit is one with the Holy Spirit, and He guides your spirit as the two of us become one. Now, we're living in a day where there is a lot of division in America. We all know that. We're living in a day where there's a lot of division among the nations. We all know that. But we are also living in a day where there is a lot of division in the body of Christ.
Yeah.
And this ought not to be. And this is in Illinois, in New York, Texas, California, Brazil.
No exceptions.
No exception. It's universal.
No exceptions.
So I want to give you a word from our Lord Jesus. Matthew 24 has a lot to share about the last days. That's Matthew 24. The entire chapter speaks much about eschatology. Eschatology refers to end time events, the second coming of Christ, the rapture of the church, the Great Tribulation, the Antichrist. Well, in Matthew 24, listen very carefully, and I know you are, and thank you for staying engaged, even though we're communicating not here in the sanctuary with you here, right there on your couch or family room, wherever you are, we know you're totally tuned in. Thank you. Because He wants to minister to you completely today.
Amen.
But it's interesting, in Matthew 24, verse 12, says, in the latter days, last days. Well, folks, that was written 2,000 years ago. And 2,000 years ago were last days. Here we are 2,000 years later, and we are much more in the last days. So
right.
When it was penned in Matthew 24, it was considered then the start of the last days. Well, here we are 2,000 years later, last of the last days. And the Lord warns us in Matthew 24, 12, again, on this Valentine Love Day Sunday. Love Day Sunday. The Lord tells us in the last days, now here we are 2,000 years later, the love of many will grow cold. Mm. The love of many will grow cold. Now, what's interesting here, Pastor Joni, babe, what's interesting here is this word love is the Greek word.
Right. Agape.
Agape. This is the Greek word agape. Agape refers to your love for one another in the body of Christ. Your love for each other in God's kingdom. So what the word of the Lord is telling us in Matthew 24, 12, in the last days, but now let's take it further, accelerate to the last of the last days, the love of many in the church, in the church, will grow cold. The brother and sisterly love in the Lord will grow cold. And that's why today many Christians tolerate each other and not celebrate each other. This is why Christians pick fights over whether they're a Democrat or a Republican, whether they're a Trumpite or a Bidenite or something else. Listen, folks, in the last days, the love of many will grow cold and it will manifest. An ugly, rude, ungodly, immature Facebook posts and reactions to them, or things said privately. My friends, we are living in the last of the last days. But now, this verse continues. In the last days, the love of many, the Greek word for many means majority. Majority. Majority will grow cold. So,
it's alarming.
It's extremely alarming, because now we're talking to the church. That in the last days, 2,000 years ago, in the last days, 2,000 years later, now it's only accelerated. And the love for each other, the brother and sister in the Lord, agape love, the majority of the love for each other has grown cold. Which means, if majority is what I believe it is,
yeah,
and I know it is, it means, hear me, in the body of Christ, in the body of Christ, the body that Jesus suffered, bled, and died for, there will be more people out of love with each other than in love with each other.
Mm.
That's why more people get offended and less people are loving. That's why less people are serving, less people are giving. I'm talking overall now.
Mm-hmm.
In the universal Church of Christ. When I say universal, I mean the entire body. Not universalism like a false religion. I don't mean that.
Right.
But here we are 2,000 years later, and the Lord told us that in the latter days, the majority of the church will lose their fervency and love and honor and respect for each other. And just like Jesus said, it's happened. What are we going to do about it?
Yeah.
I'm asking you right now, what are we going to do about it? What is Encounter Church going to do about it? What's Jim and Joni DiPalma going to do about it? What are you going to do about it? I believe this can be reversed. I believe this can be reversed. And even if we're the minority, may the minority rule, and may us be the lovers in the mighty name of Jesus, because nothing is greater and more powerful than love. This is why love is what, babe?
Challenged.
This is why love is challenged most. In every area of our lives. What's challenged most? Love.
Yeah.
Love is challenged most. Keep that in mind. In fact, let's just take a moment right now. Father, we pray.
Yes.
Babe, over this verse, just seal it now in the people's hearts.
Father, we pray, Lord Jesus, that the love of many will not grow cold, Father. That majority would be turned around and reversed, Father, because like a fox that's trying to spoil the vine, Lord, we capture that fox. We capture, Father God, that attitude of not walking in love, Father. And we desire this day and we purpose this day to walk in love, Father God, as mature Christians, Lord, knowing who we are and what we have and what you've given us, Father. In the name of Jesus, thank you, Lord God, that no longer, Father God, are the days of us not walking in love, but Father, we choose every day, every moment of the day, Father, help us to choose to walk in love, your agape love, Father God, because we know that this love never fails, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus.
Jesus, thank you, Lord. Because when we don't walk in love, we get easily agitated.
Yeah. We open the door to a whole arena of things that are just very unbecoming.
Yeah. Annoyance, short-tempered, mm-hmm. impatient.
And those things can spiral into many more things that are ugly and negative.
But you just prayed, babe. And we believe for all of us. And we're not saying, church, that you don't love. What I'm saying is we need to all love even more so. Mm-hmm. And if there's somebody watching right now, because there's people from all over that is not walking in love, we pray that you would heed it to my wife's prayer. And that by the end of today, we'll be walking love machines. How about that? Somebody comment, we'll be walking love machines.
That's good.
It's hard to argue love. It's hard to argue love. It is.
So now there's a couple songs. There's a lot of great songs that speak about love. I mean, probably about just every song that's written is written about love, right?
Many of them, most of them,
right? But how about Captain and Tennille's "Love Will Keep Us Together"?
Captain and Tennille, do you remember them?
Oh, I do.
You remember Captain and Tennille?
I do. We're showing our age now, right?
Help me.
And they were brother and sister, right?
Were they brother and sister? I'm not sure.
But anyway, maybe a husband and wife, I don't know. But Captain and Tennille wrote some really good songs.
Come on, help me.
Do, 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 do. Love will keep us together. Do, 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 do.
But it's so true. Truly, folks. Love will keep us together.
Yes.
Love doesn't write ugly emails.
Right.
Love honors, cherishes, and respects one another, regardless of indifferences. Mm-hmm. Love covers a multitude of sin.
Amen.
All right.
Amen. It's like love needs to be at the forefront of so many of our decisions and communications. Love should always be at the forefront. Mm-hmm. And if not, it's almost like a check and balance. It's like, do I have frustration at the forefront? Let me just take a breath here and let me make sure that my love is at the forefront.
I'm just a love, here Mark just said, I'm just a love machine. Wasn't that a song?
Yep.
I'm just a love machine. Oh, okay. Somebody's saying, So Ida's saying that the Carpenters were, okay, they were brothers.
The Carpenters were brothers and sisters, but Captain and Tennille were husband and wife then?
Ida, we're talking about Captain and Tennille, baby.
No, I think she's maybe saying.
Oh, the Carpenters
cause
were brothers.
Thinking brother okay. and sister, she probably thinks I'm getting confused with them.
Okay, Captain and Tennille were
husband and wife.
All right, whatever.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Ida. Thank you
for this vital information.
Thank you, Annie.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ida. Thank you, Annie.
We appreciate that.
And look what Mark said, or McWalters. I'm just a love machine. Do you know what I mean? How'd that one go?
I don't know.
I'm just a love. You see, guys, if you were here in person, if we were here in person, I'm just a love machine.
It's a good disco tune.
Disco tune. There you go. You guys are funny.
All right, let's continue on.
Yeah. We're not done with the music.
Diane Warwick, she sings the song, "What the World Needs Now Is Love, Sweet Love." Now, how about it? That's a coined verse, but you know what? That is so true.
It's the only thing that there's just too little of. It's the only thing that there's just too little of. That's from Diane Warwick. Yep.
Right.
So we all need to love, 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 love. All right.
Awesome.
Now, let's see what Jesus has to say regarding love.
Oh, let's do that.
Take it, babe.
So in Matthew 5, we'll start at verse 43.
Oh, hold on. Mitch is saying that was way before my time. Mitch, who are you fooling, buddy? That's The Rock. Mitch, who are you fooling? All right? Before your time. All right. Anyway, go ahead. We're having fun this morning, aren't we?
It is.
But it's a serious matter, too.
It is.
You know, in the last days, the majority of the church will lose their love. Not in this house. Come on. Somebody say, not in this house. Way before my time. People are giving their laughter on this. Mm-hmm. Oh, Alan is saying, yeah, it was a disco tune. Alan was in the disco, you know. Alan and Dolly. Staying alive, staying alive. Staying alive. I repent. Okay. I repent not for singing that. I repent for not doing it like the Bee Gees could do it. Okay.
Oh, okay. But you have a nice voice.
Anyway, talk to us. Tell us about Jesus. We want to know about
Jesus. Matthew 5, starting in verse 43, it says, there is a saying, you shall love your friends and hate how your enemies treat you. Mm-hmm. But I say to you, love your enemies, bless those who curse you, do good to those who hate you, and pray for those who mistreat you and persecute you.
Ooh.
Wow. Let's just stop and just think about that for a moment. Mm-hmm. But I say to you, love your enemies, right? Bless those who curse you. Oh boy, how come I'm hearing nails on a chalkboard right now? Bless those who curse you. Really? I know. Don't even think that.
That's Jesus saying.
That's right. Because if I understand, but there's times that you have to take a breath and say, you know what, Lord, I might not be there yet, but I will. I will be there where I'm going to bless those who curse me. Because you know what? That's what the Lord wants us to do and where he wants us to be. But nevertheless, that's what we should be doing, is bless those who curse us. And do good to those who hate you. You need to do good to those who hate you.
Folks, these are the words of our Lord and Savior. These are the words of our Lord and Savior. Babe, let them penetrate. Go ahead.
And really, if we want love to be at the forefront and be our priority and be our purpose, these are the things that we need to address to keep that love at the forefront.
Amen. Let's stop right for a second. Sarah, we love you too. We love you too. And Aaron, give him my love. They're in San Antonio. San Antonio. They're telling us how much they love us. We love you guys too. And happy Valentine's Day.
Yes.
And as you know, Dennis is one of my dearest, dearest friends in the world. We're praying to him and Christine.
Yes.
And for all the church there in San Antonio.
Absolutely.
We love you all.
They're our extended family.
Yep. We love you all. We love you all, guys. Go ahead, baby. Let this penetrate. Let this penetrate.
But so I say to you, love your enemies. Bless those who curse you.
Say that again.
Bless those who curse you.
Not curse those who curse you?
No. Do good to those who hate you. And pray for those who mistreat you and persecute you.
Pray for them. Pray for them.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. Doesn't say get revenge.
No
gossip
revenge.
Gossip about them.
And no revenge. It covers every base. In other words, there's no getting around this. We need to walk in love. And if we're going to walk in love, these things have to be addressed. Because you will have a day in your life that somebody's going to rub you the wrong way and not like you. And whether they say it or not, or you feel it or not, you still need to love them, pray for them, bless them. And even if you know that they've mistreated you, and they're, you know, trying to really hurt you and do you in, you need to love them, pray for them. And you know what? When we do that, we put it in God's hands then. Because God will have his way with those people, and who knows, maybe they're on the brink of salvation.
Yep.
And that's their last out, because many times hurt people hurt people. So if they're a hurting soul, they're going to come at you and try to hurt you. So we have to look beyond and allow ourselves to see the bigger picture and know that, hey, I'm going to do my part. I can't control what they're going to do, but I can control what I'm going to do. So that's what we do. All right? Let's go on with it. Verse 45 says, in that way you will be acting as true sons and daughters. How many want to be a true son and daughter? I know I do. When I meet the Lord, when it comes my day or rapture takes place, whatever comes first, I want the Lord to be able to say to me, you know, Joni, you are truly a true daughter. I want him to say that to me. And I know you do too, right? So it says, in that way, you'll be acting as true sons and daughters of your Father in heaven. Oh, Doesn't that sound good? For he makes the sun rise on the evil and on the good. So the sun is going to rise and set on your enemies, whether we like it or not, and sends rain on the good and the bad. So he's going to test everyone, and he's going to give equal opportunities to everyone. But if we're going to hold on to grudges, isn't that funny? We're going to hold a grudge. You know, I don't have a grudge. I'm holding on to a grudge. If we're going to hold those things, then we're not giving God anything to work with. So we got to release it and give it to the Lord. And now I'm going to do my part. And in doing my part, I'm giving it to the Lord. And in doing that, then God's going to send the rain. He's going to send the good. He's going to send the evil. Whatever it is, it's going to be in God's hand. It's going to be in God's hand. God could do a greater work of reconciliation and restoration than we could, right? Mm-hmm. So he gives all equal opportunities to us as well. Because sometimes we're at fault, and we think, you know, it's all them. And I know I used to say this to the kids all the time. Hey, you're pointing a finger, you know, and you got three fingers pointing back at you. So examine yourself first before you start, you know, holding grudges and, you know, saying evil things about people. Know that you're responsible too. All right? And this is all part of guarding our love and walking in love. All right, I think you got it. All right, so we're going to go on to verse 46. If you love those who love you, what reward do you have? Even corrupt tax collectors do that. And if you only are kind and only greet your own people, what more are you doing than others? Do not even unbelievers do the same? Verse 48, just as your heavenly Father is complete in showing love to everyone, so also must you. Our heavenly Father is complete, and he wants to make us complete. And we're a work in progress. And as long as we continue to do what we know to do, God's not going to look at us for the things that we don't know to do. But the things that we do know to do, those are the things that God is going to test us in and wait to see how we're going to act and react. And God wants us to pass the test. So, just as your Heavenly Father is complete in showing love to everyone, so also must you, must we, must I. Amen? Amen. And then in 1 Corinthians 13, verses 7 through 8, it says, love bears all things, love believes all things, love hopes all things, love endures all things, love never fails. Wow, that's a complete package. It bears, it believes, it hopes, it endures, and it never fails. Wow, what a deal, what a gift. What a blessing, right? And we know, too, that love, too, is a selfless thing. You know, and being selfless is putting yourself aside. And if someone needs you to have heavy shoulders, that's you. Have the heavy shoulders for them. Not being defensive or taking things personally. Selfless also means that you empathize. With what your loved one is going through, and you put your own feelings aside to be strong where they can't be strong. Isn't that a beautiful, that's just a beautiful picture, to be strong for someone when they can't be strong, to be someone's shoulder to cry on when they don't have a shoulder to cry on. Mm. That really is love, isn't it? And that's what God wants us to be. And I believe that within each and every one of us, there's a motivation within us to want to be that and do that. And that's God in you. And you need to not squelch that and put that down. You need to let that rise up in you. And God's going to give you opportunities and people in your life to reach out to and pray for and believe God with people and come into agreement with them and be those very things that they desire, to help them through those hard times. Because you know what? When it's your turn that you're going through a hard time, someone will be there for you. I don't know if we'll be that person, but someone will be there for you.
It's like sowing and reaping, right?
That's right. That's right. All right, so then let's read a little paraphrased of what's written here. Love is unconditional. It's committed. Love is committed. It tells the truth. Love tells the truth. It tells the truth.
Some people think he doesn't love me because he's not speaking the way I want him to speak. If somebody loves you, they'll speak the truth in love.
That's right. Love does not compromise. Love believes the best. Love is quick to forgive. You know what? I've learned, you know what? When it's time to forgive, don't wait. Just do it. It's almost like just hold your nose and just jump into the pool. Just like do it. If you know what has to be done, just do it. Because if you wait, it's gonna like get harder and harder and harder. So you know what? When you know that you need to say, please forgive me, I was wrong, it makes it so much more easy when you just do it quickly. You know, just, I mean, with heart and purpose too, though.
Yeah, I mean, look at that. I mean, just in back to 1 Corinthians 13:7-8, just back to that. Love bears all things, love believes all things, love hopes all things, love endures all things, love never fails.
It's a complete package,
right? Keep going, baby, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
So also love, that's okay. Love gets the facts. Oh, love gets the facts. You know, let's just talk about that for a minute. Because how often are we tempted when we hear, you know, the first story, we like, oh, what? What? They did what? Oh, that's terrible. Oh, right? And really, when the full story comes out, it maybe we wouldn't have had that same reaction if we heard the full story, right? So love gets the facts. So we need to get the facts before we jump to conclusions, right? So love gets the facts before it reacts. Love goes the distance, right? It goes the distance. Like I was speaking before about the heavy shoulders. I think that's part of going the distance. Love is not judgmental and defensive.
Say that again.
Love is not judgmental and defensive, right? Mm-hmm. It's patient. It carries no bitterness.
What?
Carries no bitterness.
Really?
That's right. And it carries no resentment. So if we're going to walk in truly God's love, we have to release all bitterness and all resentment. Love stops the bleeding.
Ooh, come on now.
How about that?
Come on.
When things are, it's almost like when the drama is pursuing, it's like who's going to be the one daring enough to just put a halt to it and call a spade and stop the bleeding and stop the carrying on, right? Love holds no grudges. Grudges are weights that hold you down. Isn't that the truth? Sometimes you know when somebody's carrying something that's not good because they look weighted down and they're holding something they shouldn't hold on to. That's why they're so weighted.
So true.
Love's not selfish. It's not opinionated. It's forbearing.
It's not what?
Opinionated.
We have a lot of opinions today in America.
My mom and dad used to say to me, keep your opinions to yourself. Love unites and reasons together.
It what?
Unites.
Love does?
Yes. That's a good thing, right?
And the Lord's returning for a united church?
It does not take vengeance or retaliate. It protects and is loyal.
It's what?
It protects and is loyal. Just saying those words is like soothing ointment, right? It keeps covenants.
It does what?
It keeps covenants.
Love?
Love keeps
And that's
covenants.
Why you and I are together.
That's right.
We made a covenant with each other. And are things always wonderful?
No.
I mean, I'm always wonderful.
Oh, of course.
But are things always wonderful? No, I'm not always wonderful. No one is always wonderful.
Right.
But covenant sticks.
Covenant is like glue.
Somebody comment, covenant sticks. Covenant is like glue.
It takes on no offense.
What does?
Covenants take on no offense. Relationships take on no offense.
Love takes on no offense.
Turns the other cheek.
Really?
Gives even when not received back.
Woo!
Covers nakedness.
Let me just say something about it gives. Would you say it gives what?
When not received back.
Yeah, that's like you, babe. You're a giver and a giver and a giver and a giver.
Mm.
And even if you're not reciprocated, you still give and give and give.
Thank you, babe. Love, weakness, and exposes strength. Love covers nakedness. Love covers weakness and exposes strength.
That's a good word right there. I learned that message years ago. I should share that with the armor bearers, that love not only covers weaknesses, but love exposes somebody's strength. So in other words, they focus and have their priorities in their eyes in the right place, rather than just looking at somebody saying, oh, I know this ugly thing about him or about her. They focus on the positive about the person, not the negative. And that's what love does for all of us, yes.
Love is faithful. It does not play the blame game.
Ooh, say that one again.
Love is faithful and it does not play the blame game.
Somebody comment that.
It does not look for faults.
Does not look for faults.
Doesn't look for faults.
See, a religious spirit, judgmental spirit, looks for faults.
Mm.
But love does not.
Love sees one's character, not character flaws. Makes no accusations. Love is humble. It sees through God's eyes and keeps no record of wrong.
Keeps no record of wrong.
It's beautiful.
Beautiful. All in 1 Corinthians 13:7-8.
Mm-hmm. In 1 John 4:20, it says, if someone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar.
So read that again. Read just a little more slowly. I just wanted to penetrate even more. It's good stuff.
If someone says, I love God, and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who doesn't...
No, hold on. No one ever says, I hate my brother. I mean, some may.
Right.
Some may. But what John is saying here when he says, if you hate your brother, he's really saying is if you don't honor them, give them the time of day.
Right.
Show them respect.
Right.
Right? Be polite. Say it again.
So... 1 John 4:20, if someone says, I love God and hates his brother, he is a liar. For he who does not love his brother whom he has seen, how can he love God whom he has not seen? So I love that because if we're going to say we love God, right, and we can't see him, but yet right next door to us is a brother or a neighbor, or a person that we say we don't love, you know, how can we say that? When we see that person and we say, I don't love them.
Yeah.
You know, it's not right.
I mean, if you can't love me and respect me, or respect each other in whom you can see.
Right.
Then how can you say you love God and respect God and submit to God whom you do not see.
Do not see.
I hear people say, well, I submit to God, but I don't submit to man. Well, I love God, but I don't love man. You know, the Bible says we're only fooling ourselves. We're deceiving ourselves. How can anyone say I love God and disrespect and mistreat his own brother? The Bible says you're a liar. I'm not calling you a liar. I'm telling you what the word says.
Right.
That if you're not submitted to God's authority, because I know some Christians say, well, God told me to do this, and right away, can't argue with God. Can't argue with God. And yes, you want to be led by God. But here, John's making it very simple, being very practical, that if you really love God, you'll prove it by loving each other, whom you can see. If you really submit to God, then you'll prove it by submitting to one another. Right?
Right, I like that.
Let's close this down.
Don't fight for what you can get.
Listen to this, I like this.
Don't fight for what you can get. Fight for what you can give.
Say that again.
Don't fight for what you can get. Fight for what you can give.
Now that would make a good Facebook post. If you want to go ahead and do it, go ahead and do it. Don't fight for what you can get. Fight for what you can give. And America needs to hear this. The church. I'm not too concerned about my country. I'm concerned about the church. Because if the church is where it needs to be in love, everything else will work out in America. People are trying to fix the world when they themselves are in disarray. We gotta work on ourselves. Work out our own salvation with fear and trembling. Don't fight for what you can get. Fight for what you can give. There you go, right? And how about this one, Pastor Joni? Come on, say that boldly.
Love the hell out of people. Just love them, love them, love them, and just love the hell right out of them.
Literally. Wouldn't that be sarcastic? Tell them.
That's right. No, it's the truth. It's the truth. Because if love never fails and it believes the best about people, then the hell that's in somebody or the disarray or the whatever that's in somebody.
Yeah.
The dysfunction will have
will
be challenged.
Yeah.
And hopefully it leaves them.
Yes. When we say love the hell out of them, you know, misery is hell.
Right.
You know, anger is hell. Judgmentalism is hell. Gossip is hell.
Right.
People talking behind your back is hell. People not supporting you and holding up your arms. Like Aaron and Hur did to Moses, and you get weaker and weaker and you get discouraged. Those are hellish situations. So what are you supposed to do? Take that hell out of them by loving them.
Right.
Love supports. Love shows up. Love encourages. Love does what it needs to do when it feels like it or not. Pain and pain-free. Yes.
Yeah, so like I said before, love needs to be at the forefront.
Yes. Right? All right.
And also I wanted to say, you know, sometimes the body of Christ and just people in general have bailout mentality.
Say it again.
You know, and bailing out is not the way to go. Because you might think that, oh, that's the easier way out. Well, it's not.
The grass is greener?
It's not. It's not. Because I see that as a challenge that you're totally backing off from and backing away from.
Running from.
Exactly. And if you don't face it, then it's gonna greet you again down the road.
Yeah. Somebody said, well,
so
I'm
bailing
gonna
out.
I'm sorry.
Bailing out is not the way to go. You know, I'm leaving that church because I don't like that what they said, so I'm gonna go find myself another church.
And the same thing.
I'm leaving this marriage because they don't love me where I'm, you know. Bailing out is not the mentality. You know, we need to love and believe the best and stand our ground.
I was going
to
say that. Stand your ground. Somebody said the other day,
believe God for your relationship. Believe God for, I mean, if God's called you to a body of believers, then you stay there.
Yeah. Yes. If God's called you to a job and maybe your boss is being hard on you, you don't like the work atmosphere, don't say, well, don't encourage that person to get another job. Encourage them to stay there and welcome the challenge.
Right.
Because there's always something on the job or in a church or in a relationship that you're going to disagree with. So there's only so many places you can run and hide. So if we're true to ourselves, we'll pass the test where we are and will flourish where we are planted. I'm not saying God could never call or lead on, but it has to be for the godly purposes and godly motives that pleases the Lord, that enhances. But many times we're quick to run.
Right. And 1 John 3:18 says, my little children, love one another. Love, and it says, let us not love in word or in tongue, but in deed and in truth.
Yes.
I I mean, that kind of capsulizes so much.
Yes, yes. In Jude, there's only one chapter, verse 20. This is interesting here. Pastor Derek, if you would come on up. Thank you. And Amy, you can come on up as well, hon. But in Jude, there's only one chapter. Listen to this very carefully. And I know you guys are. You guys are so sweet. You're sweethearts. But you, beloved, that's you, the church.
Right.
Building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. So Jude 20 says it's important to pray in the tongues, pray in the Spirit, because it builds your spirit. However, the next verse, verse 21 says, but keep yourselves in the love of God. In other words, tongues are important. But what good is tongues if you don't keep yourself in the love of God? What good is praying in tongues, praying in the Spirit, if you don't love your brother? If you're not going after him and showing him love, and going out of your way and showing them love. Keeping yourselves in the love of God, listen, verse 21, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Mercy. Sometimes it's difficult to love. That's where you say, God, have mercy. I need mercy. So yes, verse 20 says, pray in the Spirit. It'll build your spirit. It'll build your inner man. But more than pray in the Spirit, walk in the Spirit. That is, walk in love. And keep yourselves. Keep yourselves in the love of God, because distractions come. Temptations come. People come. Voices come. Elections come. Viruses have come. Things happen.
Yeah.
Keep yourself in the love of God, by the mercies of the Lord, and unto what, babe?
Unto eternal life.
Tell the people real quickly what the Lord showed you about that.
So eternal life, that means that, you know, there's, if we really allow ourselves to broaden the picture of what God is really trying to say here, there's more to us than just what's happening on this planet. There's an eternal perspective that's yet to take place.
Right, right. So Jude 20, build yourselves up, praying on the Holy Ghost, on your most holy faith, praying on the Holy Ghost, Jude 20. Jude 21, keeping yourselves in the love of God through His mercies for eternity's sake.
For eternity's sake.
For eternity's sake.
Yep.
But Jude 22 says, see here, 20, 21, 22.
This is good.
Some, having love, compassion, making the difference. There should not be some having love, making the difference. First of all, love makes the difference.
Right.
Second of all, there should not be some. There should be all of us.
Right.
So praying in the Spirit is good. It's important. But keeping yourself in the love of God through the mercies of the Lord. When you don't know how to love, say, God, I need mercy.
Yes.
Show me how to love.
Yes.
Show me how to love.
Help me get through this, Lord. Help me.
Right. For all eternity. Because Christ is eternal.
Right.
And finally, Romans chapter 5, verse 5.
The love of God has been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. The love of God. It's been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit. Why do I love? Because the love of God's been poured into your heart.
Just the way it requires God's mercy to intervene, to love the unlovable. You know, at one time we were the unlovable. How do we go the distance and show each other love? How do we love our nation? How do we love those in authority the way God said so?
Yeah.
And show an honor and respect even when we disagree. It requires the mercy of God that you need to call on every day. But here, as Pastor Joni read in Romans 5:5, the love of God has been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit, which means not only the mercies of God, but it takes the work of the Holy Spirit to help me to continue to love. I've been preaching for many years. I've been standing for many years. Sometimes good, sometimes feeling well, sometimes not feeling well. But it's the Holy Spirit. It's not Jim DePalma. It's the Holy Spirit in Jim DePalma that allows me to keep loving, to keep loving. Someone may say, well, if somebody hurts you and they don't love you anymore, are you going to think that I'm not going to love you anymore? I can't think that way. We cannot afford to think that way. A woman may say, I can never be married again because I was hurt by a man. You can. I can never attend church again because I was hurt by a church. You can. But you have to call upon the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Call upon the Holy Spirit. Because it's not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. And the Holy Spirit will help you love. When you want to say something irrational, when you want to say something that may be ugly or get revenge, say, Holy Spirit, stop me now, I pray. Help me to love everyone and honor and respect. And then the Lord will return for a church without spot, blemish, or wrinkle. People of love, people that are loving, people that walk in love, walk in peace.
Yes.
People that walk in peace, walk in strength. Mm. People that walk in strength, walk in unity. People that walk in unity, favor from heaven falls and flows. This has been the word of the Lord. Stretch your hands right now toward Pastor Joni and I. Honey, release it upon them.
Now, Father God, I release upon your people, Father, everyone in the sound of my voice, I release the love of the Father upon each and every one. May they continue on this day, Lord, and may the north, the south, the east, the west of them be blessed of you, Father. In the name of Jesus, and may they walk in love, and may they walk in that serenity and that pureness of your love, Father, with all peace.
Yes, Lord.
Thank you, Father, in the name of Jesus.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Remember, the root is the heart. Guard your heart. Protect, like a boxer. Mm-hmm. Protect your heart.
Yes.
Out of it flows the issues of life. We ask right now that the blood of Jesus, church, cleanse us.
Amen.
Of all unrighteousness.
Yes, Father.
Thoughts, words spoken, deeds, mindsets that we've entertained, unrightful seeds of words or attitudes. Father,
yes.
Cleanse us by the blood. And on this Valentine's Day, where it's really cold outside here in Bartlett, Illinois, may the warmth of your Spirit touch the people. And through your mercy and through the power of the Holy Spirit, may we walk in tremendous love in Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Pastor Derek and Amy are going to lead you in a song. Let's sing together and we'll be right back.
As long as there is love, we will stay.
great song, isn't it? My friend Russ Taff wrote that song. Like Amy said, just grab that hand. And we speak love back into your marriage.
Yes.
Love back into your ministry. Love into your children. The blessings of the Lord maketh one rich. Love never fails. Through the grace of God, the mercy of the Lord, and the work of the Holy Spirit. Right, Shiloh? Right, big girl? Pastor Joni wanted her up here. Right, big girl? We love you.
We do.
Happy Valentine's Day.
Yes.
A few months ago, we thought, hey, if the weather was good today as far as going out, we'd have a drive-through and we'd have candy or something for you. But
yeah.
I think you're better off staying home today, right? But as we worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings, and you see, love gives. Love loves to give. So today we have the opportunity to worship the Lord with our tithes and offerings. If you're going to go out later today, if you are, you can come to the church. If you're going to go out, or if it's too cold, just come tomorrow. But we want to honor the Lord for today's tithes and offering, first fruits. You can just go to the website and give on
PayPal.
Thank you. You can call the church. You can mail in your check. But however you do it, let's honor the Lord for this Sunday and this week. And Encounter Church, let me say this, Encounter Church. You guys are a blessing.
Yes.
And you guys know about tithing and offering and first fruits and oblations. You prove it. We love you for that, church.
We do.
Thank you for being mature. So now we speak blessings over your harvest in Jesus' name. And again, if you're writing a check, you can make it out to Encounter. However you plan on doing it today, whichever of those four ways will let you be led by the Holy Spirit, let's just do it and seal the deal. And we thank you because we're able to allow this ministry to keep going and keep going because of your faithfulness in giving your tithes and offerings. It's the only way that we have finances coming in through the people. And thank God for you, but we thank God for his love is greater than our love. And therefore, may he bless your harvest even greater.
Amen.
Through his love.
Amen.
We thank the Lord for your marvelous Monday, terrific Tuesday, wonderful Wednesday, tremendous Thursday, fabulous Friday, sensational Saturday, and another super Sunday. We love you with all of our hearts. Again, if our arms are long enough, we'd give you one big hug. If our lips are big enough, we'd give you one big
kiss.
Happy Valentine's Day, no matter who you are, where you are.
Yes.
We're your Valentine, and Jesus is as well. We love you. God bless you.